Hi everyone and welcome back to another video. My name is Courtney if you don't know me already. In today's video we've got a video request from Tom. Now I'm looking forward to this video. We are checking out WWE for the first time. I've just never really gotten into it before, so maybe this video will change my mind. We will see. So this video is The Undertaker and Mick Foley relive their infamous Hell in a Cell match, WWE Untold. So we're gonna check it out today, guys. Let me know what you guys think down below, and without any further ado, we are gonna get straight into it. This is so funny because we've been talking about WWE on my stream.
Honestly,
on my Twitch lately.
I did not expect him to get up from that. He hit and finally he started moving around. I was like, man, that's one tough son of a gun right there.
On June 28, 1998, The Undertaker threw Mankind off the roof of the Cell in a Cell. I missed him. On the 20-year anniversary, WWE collected the first-hand stories of the match participants, Undertaker, Mick Foley, and others.
Well, my feud with The Undertaker had actually ended a while earlier. I thought we were entering a match cold. I thought my character had been through a lot and people had lost interest in it. After watching the first ever Cell match between Shawn Michaels and The Undertaker, I realized I was in a terrible predicament to even try to approach the level that they had reached was going to be very difficult. And I just didn't see how it would be possible without something special.
I can guarantee that Mankind will have a surprise for everyone that you will not soon forget.
If we can do something special, if we can start a match in a way that no one ever has, maybe we can fool people into thinking we're having a great match, even if we're not.
I'm not sure exactly what had happened, but Undertaker broke his foot. And we weren't sure, how that was going to play out.
Yeah, I did happen to have a fracture in my ankle. It was such an important time in the business. You knew you had to do it, so you just grit your teeth and go in there and do what you do.
That compounded the troubles that we were facing. Yeah, The Undertaker and I reminisced about that a couple of years ago. Like, what were we even doing in that situation? Like, and yet he willingly entered it with a broken foot, which speaks volumes as to what type of competitor he is.
Oh, look out! The Undertaker is here, and he's walking with purpose. Oh, this is going to be bad.
I don't remember the build-up to that day, other than being approached by Mr. McMahon and him asking me if I had been up on top of that structure earlier in the afternoon. And I assured him I had, which was the biggest lie I'd told up to that point in my life. And then he asked me if I was comfortable up there, and I assured him I was, which became the newest, biggest lie I'd ever told in my life, because if I had ever gone up on top of that structure in the afternoon, I wouldn't have been scaling it that evening, because it was terrifying, absolutely terrifying. I know there are people in the WWE Universe, superstars, who are not afraid of heights. I'm not one of them.
He just even had that arm, like a harness on or anything.
The reaction, even with a normally hot crowd, was a little bit lukewarm until we got up on top of the Cell.
Mankind!
What's he doing? Well, he's trying to get up to the top of the cage.
Well, I'd see that, but...
Wait, what? So this is the first time he ever did it?
He's not very logical. I mean, he needs therapy.
Like, crap, am I going to be able to get up there? The answer was yes, because I don't know how. I mean, I would have got up there. I don't care how, but I would have got up there. It was definitely an exciting way to start off a Cell match, to start out on top.
There are moments when our feet are actually sinking into the mesh. like we're tearing holes in the mesh as we walk, which should have been a harbinger for even worse things to come.
They're destroying the Hell in the Cell. And my God, don't get them over here where we are.
I still remember clearly the distinct sound of the wire coming unwound or breaking from the pressure of our weight. But funny enough, I felt safer on the edge or the poling of the cage.
And I just remember getting a couple of really quality chair shots to the back. I think Jerry Lawler said,
"It puts goosebumps on my back there. It makes the hair on my neck stand up. I like it."
And the next thing I know, I was in flight.
Wait, we saw this at the start of the video, didn't we? I didn't quite understand what was going on.
Everything you heard me say was spontaneous and real. So that call has a pulse.
I cannot believe it's over. That cage is 16 feet high.
When I tossed him off of there, and you know, as I was watching him fall, and it seemed like it took forever for him to hit the table. It was like only thing I could liken it to is whatever an outer body experience. It was so crazy, and it was so loud in there with the people. At that point, nothing like that had ever been done.
Believe me, I was almost having a heart attack watch what was going on. And I got to Mick. I'm asking him, are you okay? And he gave me the sign
that
I can continue, which flabbergasted Mick.
He said something kind of quietly, and then I heard him say it again, my shoulder. So I called for a stretcher, and in order for the stretcher to get there, we had to lift the Hell in the Cell up. So with the Undertaker still on the top of the Hell in the Cell, it started moving upward.
Why is the cage raising? Do they realize the Undertaker is still on top of the cage? They're raising the cage with the Undertaker still on top. What?
Obviously, I know they raised the cage, but I was kind of oblivious to it, really. I was so zoned in and what
we
were doing at that point. You know, I'm kind of up there without any kind of communication with anything or anybody. I was just like, well, I guess I'm not going anywhere until they bring me down.
We got Nick about halfway back. He started saying, "No, I want to go back. I said, "No, you're not going anywhere. You're going back, you know, you're going to hospital." And the next thing I know, Nick jumps up. He started climbing up to Hell in a Cell again. He started going up to the top.
And look at him. You're kidding me. How in the hell is he standing?
Oh, my God.
And look at this. He's got a smile on his face, for God's sakes. Are you kidding me? He wants to go back.
See, this must be, it must be part of it though, yeah?
So is the Undertaker. No way!
I'm not an expert on WWE, but...
Oh my God, the Undertaker!
It was epic though, I can't even lie.
This is absolutely amazing.
Everybody in the building thought the match was over. I didn't know for sure if I could, but I said I was going to give it my best try. But by the time I got to the top of the cell, I was just about out of energy. So I look back and I wish that I'd had the strength and the energy to exchange with the Undertaker, but I'm thankful that I didn't in retrospect, because if I'd had the strength to exchange, I also would have had the strength to get off the cell for the choke slam.
Enough.
The poor son of a, he's broken in half. And the Undertaker likes it. But I think enough is enough.
Knowing what we know and knowing that structure gave way. I believe that if I'd gone up in a way that I usually did for choke slams, that would afford me the safest landing on a mat inside a ring, that I would have over-rotated and landed high on my shoulders and likely never wrestled again.
I totally agree with that. We're talking a matter of a couple of inches, even the way he landed. I mean, that could have been catastrophic. I mean, it really could have. But I stepped off of the panel and onto the support bars. If I hadn't have done that, we'd have both gone through that together. So if you could imagine, if I had stayed on that panel, my weight would have probably been on him too. And then what happens? It's a scary thought.
It just was an incredible thud, and it just made you sick to see it. And we could see something, you know, in his nose.
I remember punching
him. Oh, that's not him. That's not
trying to talk some sense into him, but also being just distracted by this huge, what I thought was a booger in his nose. Come to find out that it was one of his incisors that it went through his lip and ended up in his nose.
And I had the presence of mind to think that if I could just find a way to stick my tongue through that massive wound and wriggle it, that it would create a compelling image.
No!
I knew I was going to be okay.
Oh my. Oh. And he's smiling.
Uh-oh.
He is smiling.
No, I can't.
Nick had basically just had two really bad car accidents.
Is this for real?
Still had the fortitude to get back to his feet and say, we're going to finish this. I mean, that's just another cut of human being right there.
I don't know it got so bloody.
I really am. I don't know if I should just say the match is over. And then he grabs me and he goes, where are the tacks?
Oh, God. What is that? Thumbtacks.
Oh, my gosh, that is ruthless. No way, no way, no way, no way, no way. No, no,
you know,
no.
Just the glittery, you know, the shininess of the tacks. And I guess in retrospect,
no,
we needed something like that and seemed like a suitable way to end that match.
No, no, no! No.
The tacks were probably the easiest part of the night. It was definitely icing on the cake for him, you know, for him. He ended up in a bed of tacks. So it was a rough night for Mick Foley.
But he put the tacks down.
And even as I was, as Timmy White was counting three, you know, that I believe the right foot was just kicking ever so gently to show, like, I'm not completely out of this ball game yet. Mike Chioda, who was not the referee of record, but he came out and told me they were bringing a stretcher out for me. And he said, and I can see, you can look on the video and you can see I lift my arm. And the reason I lift my arm is I didn't want anyone in Pittsburgh to see me talking. And what I said to him was, have I already been on a stretcher tonight? And when he informed me that I had, that right arm went up about 3 seconds after that for a second time, and I said, I can't be on two stretchers in one night. And I hobbled my way to Mr. McMahon's room.
We took him back and put him on a table. He went to let me know that his shoulder was hurt, but he smiled at me and I could see, you know, that he had a gash under his lip. They started stitching him up right there. Just an incredible sight to see.
Mr. McMahon sat me down, and I remember those words specifically. He said, you have no idea how much I appreciate what you've done for this company, but I never want to see anything like that again.
It's everlasting. It's in our minds forever, and it's like any other
I
great event in wrestling or mainstream sports. It's that play that defined the game.
I couldn't ask for a better human being to do that with than Mick. These are things that, like I said, that I haven't really talked about. There's probably only a handful of people that I would, you know, open myself up like that to, he being one of them. It's really special to be still be considered such an iconic match and one that people really, you know, have all these really fond memories of, that just lets us know we did something right.
It was the reactions to the unexpected, and I think that element of surprise, it embeds it in people's minds, so that anyone who was there in the venue or watching live when it happened will never forget that moment. This moment or series of moments has left this indelible imprint on people's memories. We're somehow able to create an image in people's minds that lives on and will outlive me and The Undertaker both.
What the heck? You guys, I'm kind of shocked, you guys. So this is pretty much the first time that I've seen WWE, like a proper clip. And I'm left with kind of, I don't want to say confusion, I guess like I'm intrigued. So I always thought that WWE was all script written, and I think majority is, right? So in this situation, I'm trying to figure out, was this a script or was it actually really real? I don't know. But either way, that was crazy. And honestly, now I can see why that people go to these WWE shows. I think watching in the stadium or at the venue would be such a unique experience and a really fun experience. So this video has definitely changed my mind about WWE in general. That was insane. So I'm just trying to, that was a lot, but I liked that. Oh my gosh, there was so much going on. I didn't know that they actually, like, I knew they put their body on the line and everything, but I didn't know they got all bloodied up and actual injured. I thought they just did stunts but didn't actually hurt themselves. I'm shook. He literally got backslammed into some pins. He literally got thrown off a cage into a table. He literally got thrown through a cage roof onto the floor. And his lip was all broke. Either way, there's dedication to the job. Wow. Let me know if you can answer any of my questions down below. Let me know if you're a fan of WWE. Can you tell that I'm shook? That was just a lot. Again, this is the first WWE clip I've seen. Like, actual sat down and seen. I've seen snippets here and there. I've never really been interested in it, but that was a 15 minute long clip of intensity. Are we on the same level here or not really? Am I the only one on this level right now? Yeah, let me know what you guys thought about that video. That was insane and actually really enjoyable. So thank you so much, Tom, for sending this one through. Crazy. Yeah, like this video if you did like it. And apart from that, I'm going to head off now and I will see you all in my next video. Bye, guys.